I'm waiting for the live. Okay. Yes. Something is happening. All right. Now, the audio should be fixed and the live should be fine. Let's see. So, the audio is fine and the live is fine. Okay, of course I will delete, okay, now quickly, we'll talk about the sensors that we will work with, and we'll talk about the robot. And we'll also introduce a couple of some instructions in case you want to build a robot yourself, which is absolutely not requested nor mandatory in a university course, but I believe that it might be fun for those that want to play with this sort of thing. Plus, having access to a low-level device is always enlightening, I believe, for an engineer. So this is the outline, and I'm not commenting that much. And let's start with the first class of sensors that we will see, which are sensors for ego motion. Like, ego motion is like the motion of a device estimated by the reference frame of the device itself. And typically, for doing this kind of estimate, we will use two classes of sensors. Sensors which are devices, actually, which are mounted directly on the shaft of the robot, on the shaft of the motor, which are called encoders. And an encoder basically measures the revolution of a disc, and based on the position of the disc, it figures out where the shaft, what is the location of the shaft up to a certain resolution. Classical encoders are optical encoders or Hall effect encoders. Optical encoders, basically, they use a disc with holes, and the light is passing through these holes, and based on the number of times the beam of light is interrupted, they figure out the number of how much the wheel is rotating. If you have ever broken an old mouse, the one with the ball underneath, you know what I'm talking about. By contrast, Hall effect, basically they use a magnet and the Hall effect for simulating the on and off of these interruptions. And encoders, well, basically encoders are rather cheap, and you find them mostly on every possible manipulator. Rather cheap, low-end encoders. Expensive encoders can be also more than 100 euros, like the ones mounted inside, more than hundreds of euros, like the ones mounted into the industrial robots. Other class of sensors are classical accelerometers and gyros, and you're very familiar with them because you have them on your phone, and the way your phone flips the orientation of the thing is just like by an accelerometer in general. And also, now they kept also integrating gyros. I think that on Android, there is an app which is called Andro Sensor, that if you download it, you can see all the stream of the sensors of your Android device. And you can play with it, basically. Normally, this ego motion, the sensors for ego motion, they provide you only incremental estimate, basically, like the velocity. Gyro measures the rotational velocity around one or three axes, and accelerometer just measures the acceleration. What do you do if you want to figure out the position out of a velocity and acceleration? Well, you have to integrate either once or twice. And integrating results typically in integrating also the error. And so integrating the error means that if you have a constant bias, a constant small estimate at the beginning of your estimate, then if it is in the accelerometer, your error, your estimate will grow quadratically. And if it's in the gyroscope, your error in the estimate will grow linearly. So basically, if you have an error in your accelerometer, you will be bumped into the stratosphere in no time. Considering also that these devices, they go your estimate will be bumped into the stratosphere in no time, or at the center of the Earth, whatever, depending on the direction of the bias. Typically, the estimate of the ego motion is obtained, as I said, by integrating. What happens if you have a constant error in the encoders? Well, the error grows linearly with the motion of the wheel. The important thing is that in absence of an external reference system or some without observing the world, it's not possible to navigate with without for long time without by only integrating sensors for ego motion. Well, during World War II, they were sending also rockets, or they did send rockets with highly accurate gyros and accelerometer with only inertial navigation. This is what has been done during the war. In fact, the war and these sorts of things are technologically are like they tend to push a lot the technology thing. Then after war, one has to find civil use for all these things. But this was done with devices which have a cost which is basically unreachable. Like imagine that a fiber optic gyroscope, which is the model that they use in devices that then they destroy, is far above 10,000 euros, like the thousands of euro or even and so like the class of device that they use for this sort of things, also because manufacturing requires very, very small tolerances. And also, so it's not perfectly true that you can't navigate, but you can only go in a straight line or in like without too much of an articulated, stuff. But this is definitely not something we want to do and we will ever do in this course. And we will work with very cheap accelerometers and with very cheap gyros that we all can afford. So said, basically, with sensors for ego motion, you cannot, at a certain point, the error will drift. The error will be so high that that you can't cope with the position of the... You can't estimate the position of the paper. Sorry, guys, if you see me distracted, is that in this lecture hall there is all possible source of noise which is unprecedented, so not exceptional. Now, what do we do for basically avoiding our ego motion estimate to drift away and also sometimes to calibrate the bias of the sensors is that we observe the world. By observing the world, by observing the scenario, we know a very important thing. We know when we are not moving, right? So if by observing the world, well, it doesn't really matter if your accelerometer tells you, hey, you're bumping into the stratosphere. Because if I see, or you have a tiny little bias that goes up and up and up, and then if you listen your accelerometer, maybe you think you're moving very fast away. But if you observe an object which is anchored in front of you, well, you know that this object is fixed, and then you say, no, I'm not moving. And then maybe the accelerometer has a little bias. So like, and this is a way that you need to have, and in general, you need to have an external reference system that helps you to recover by these errors. And this external reference system is provided typically by the world itself. Words that you observe with specific sensors. And by observing the world, you get an indirect estimate of where you are in the world. Because the observation of the world, even the observation of the world that you make, for instance, with a camera, will depend on the location where you acquire such an image. And so it will indirectly measure the location, your location in the world. Of course, assuming that the world is stationary, right? Because if the world moves with you, well, it's another story. But let's assume that the world is stationary. So we have a large class of devices for measuring the environment, and some of them you're familiar because being millennials, you will spend quite some time in taking selfies and taking pictures. So this will be a primary sensor that we might encounter later on. But we can basically classify sensors in active and passive. Active sensors are sensors that inject energy in the environment and then observe the return of this energy to basically infer some quality. Or passive sensors that are objects that measure the tactile, devices that measure some sort of the environment energy itself, like for instance a camera. A camera doesn't radiate the environment, it uses the light intensity of the environment, present in the environment to infer or to produce an image, which in the end depends by the environment itself. Classical example are the sonars. Sonars, well, they work well in the underwater. That's where they are mostly used, because underwater the speed of sound is much higher than what it is in the air, and so are the characteristics. A sonar basically is a device that emits a pulse of sound and then waits for listening it back, waits for the echo. So emits a sound, a pulse of sound, the sound travels, it encounters a surface, and then it bounces back. So it's two sensors, basically a loudspeaker and a microphone, right? Shoots with the loudspeaker, sound travels, hits an obstacle, goes back, and then when it arrives back, knowing that it's what you have sent, you divide it basically by twice the speed of the sound in the medium that you're analyzing, and you get an estimate of the distance. The issue of the sonar is that the sound is not very directional, right? Depending on the medium, actually. In the water, it's much more directional than what it is in the depending on how you shoot it, right? Depending on the loudspeaker, but it's much more directional than what it is in the air. Basically, they are limited by the angular resolution and by the number of times, because the sound disperses according to a cone. They are limited by the angular resolution and by the basically maximum distance they can sense, because this is capped by the velocity of the signal in the medium. Because if the signal moves very slow, it means basically that, okay, I sound and then I cannot sense. For instance, if you want to sense 300 meters, you would have to, you'll have a frequency of 2 seconds, because it's around 300 and something a velocity of the sound in the air. Like, you have to consider the distance to travel, the distance to come back. So to get one single measurement, you can get the measurement at one measurement every 2 seconds. Okay? Plus, in 2 seconds, you can hear anything. You cannot even more recognize your own sound, like the sound that you emit. So, like, that's why normally sonars are capped to small distances. But in water, it's different. What happens if you substitute the sound with the light? Well, you get a laser scanner. Right? The principle is basically the same. You have a beam of light, of pulsing light, which is sent out to a laser pointer, only it's a different spectrum, and then you send modulated light, and then you measure. You have another receptor. Let's imagine it's a camera, but it's not. That is collimated with the laser itself, and then you figure out what is the range that the laser has traveled just by observing where the laser hits the wall, or the object in general. Same principle. Have you ever seen a laser meter? That's more or less the principle of the device. And normally, like, if you take this device and you mount it on a rotating mirror, then you can are able to deflect the beam by 180 to 360 degrees if the mirror is at 45 degrees, so laser, as the image shows, and then you can get a profile of the scene that you're capturing, a planar profile. If the mirror tilts also, you can have a 3D scanner, okay? Not much to say, it has been, so far it seems, I wouldn't say something wrong, but so far it seems the only thing which is safe enough to be used in the industry to stop the machinery from operating. Normally, laser scanners are used within robotic cells to prevent, at least they were used, so I don't know what happens now, to stop the robotic cell from working if a worker puts in the eye. Okay. And they were the only thing which was secure enough or approved enough to do so. And this is an example of typical scan. Well, this is a 3D model. The chair, I don't know what it's called, this thing, is obtained by a mesh, but what you get from a laser scanner is just points. The points, you get an angular measurement, an angle, which is where the beam was, and you get a range. What is the distance of the beam at that particular angle? Okay. Of course, lasers, cool lasers, are also used in archaeology, where you have these like Regal or Leica 3D scanners, which are mounted in a place to do the survey. They take 30 minutes, and you get a super dense, a super accurate point cloud, basically describing the reality of interest. But they take a lot of time to take a scan because they need to do repeated and multiple. We have a bunch of scanners in our lab. There was a new device, the Auster 128 beams 3D laser. We have to put it in good use. Hopefully some of you will do the thesis, but that's to be an approved one. Other sensors that you're very familiar with is the classical monocular camera. And you all know what is a monocular camera, right? It's what you have on your mobile phone or what you have on the reflex. You all know, but basically what the camera does is does a 2D projection of a 3D structure. And what you get is the light intensity at every point, at every pixel, no? Of the image. The pixels themselves, they are captured by a device, which is the CCD, which is a chip, basically, which contains a grid of call them light sensors, and each of these sensors will produce a response, produce a signal, which will be proportional to the number of photons that fall in this sensor, let's say. And then what happens then is that they get amplified, digitalized, and this is what you get from the classical camera. Three are the parameters of a camera, of a classical pinhole camera. One is the aperture, which is how much light passes through the diaphragm. One is the exposure time, so how open is the diaphragm, how long I let my image getting imposed. And the third is the ISO sensitivity, which is the amplification of the pixel. The higher the ISO sensitivity, the more the noise, the higher the aperture time, the more the light enters per unit of time, but the more blurry the image, because then the camera doesn't resemble anymore basically a pinhole model, and the beams pass through multiple rays. And the exposure time, well, the longer you keep the shutter open, the slower you have to move, because if the shutter is very open and if you leave it open 3 minutes, which people do for when taking a picture of the sky, for instance, well, you are picturing a lot of things, and if something is moving, then you will get shades into the thing. Or these famous photos of the highways of New York, where you see all these light tubes. These are pictures that are taken with high exposure. Okay? So these parameters are important when you acquire a data set, because you know what to tweak with. Also, the projective model of a camera doesn't need to be necessary at pinhole. Once we agree that the camera is a device that projects from 3D to 2D, you can choose an arbitrary projection to do so. You could have also a camera which is a pinhole camera, like the one that I was showing before, like the one that you all see when I do this. You see that this camera is a little bit of a Vichy effect, because the parallel lines are not, or the straight lines are not straight in this case, right? It tends to curve things. Then if you enhance this effect, because it has a wide field of view, if you enhance this effect, well, you will get a fisheye camera. Or if you decide to mount a camera on a mirror, basically, like the one that was over there, then you will get a projection of a 360-degree slice of the angle. Other classes of sensors are what is the benefit of a camera? Well, it's that it's cheap basically nowadays. And if you have only one camera, well, this is really nice because it's cheap, but it has one strong limitation that with one single camera, you need to do some black magic in order to figure out the depth of the objects. Okay? Because the camera tells you a three, it just proposes you just a 2D projection of a 3D world. And ideally, the same images could come from a world which is half the size and a camera which is half the size and produce the very same images. So the monocular camera has an inherent scale ambiguity. Anyway, with a monocular camera, we still can estimate a 3D model of the world up to a scale because you don't know how big it is. How to fix the scale? Well, take an object of known size, measure it, and determine the scale, determine how big it is. I will not talk that much about it. We may be towards the end of the course. We talk about techniques which are called structure from motion. What is the simple way of determining the depth? Well, it's instead of with cameras, well, don't use a camera, don't use two, which is basically what we have on our face. And with two cameras, well, you can determine the distance of an object. Basically by triangulation, because you know that assuming that you have an image and you are able to, or you have two images, one per each eye, and you are able to identify in the left image which point of the left image corresponds to the point of the right image, right? Like imagine that I see this corner of a monitor with my right eye and with my left eye, right? I know that this corner is the same corner, right? And then I know, actually, well, my eyes tend to adjust the parallax, but even if they wouldn't, I would be able to estimate the thing because there's only one single ray that passes from my optical, from the optical center of my eye, which is in the center of the pupil, and goes there, and there is only one other ray that satisfies the two projection equations that I have. This allows me to determine the depth of the point. And then the issue of the stereo camera is, well, quite simple. If there is no texture, there is no point that you can encounter. I don't know if it ever happened to you to enter in a room or in an environment which is completely white, where you really don't have a reference. I don't know, I made an experiment. There was a room somewhere. There was a room where basically not even the sound, right? Like, it was just white. Believe me that you couldn't figure out when you reached the wall. You had to look at the shadow because you couldn't really determine the depth of this wall. Luckily, no. If you look at the shadow, then it's fine. But if you don't see the shadow, the illumination was such that you couldn't determine with your two eyes the depth of the wall because it was completely white. And because there is no texture, there's no way you can estimate the thing. And another aspect, another issue of the classical tradition of stereo camera is the fixed baseline. So every animal has the eyes, which are at the distance, which are optimized for the job he has to do. Right? Now we have our eyes in this way, basically because they are optimal to estimate the distance of objects that we can manipulate. If we were supposed to, I don't know, hunt for far, probably we would have eyes at this distance, or we would have different resolutions. Animals, they have, like the predators have eyes in the front, and the predated ones, they have eyes on the side because they need to look at around. So like the way we are made, well, the way the sensors are built and assembled, also they resemble the purpose, right? So, but still, what do? If we don't have a texture, well, we do like we put the texture on. So if we have a camera where we substitute one of the two elements, one of the two cameras, we substitute it with a projector, which projects a very known pattern that I can easily identify on the other camera, on the left camera, for instance, then I'm done, and then I am able to have feasible input to estimate the depth of objects. Okay? And this is the principle behind RGBD cameras. Actually, RGBD cameras, so RGB, which comes from red, green, blue, so basically a regular traditional standard color camera, and D, depth. How do they add this stereo channel? Well, if you look at the Kinect or this or the Phion or this class of sensors, they do it basically by having a compound of sensor head, which is consisting of a projector, light projector, and an ER receiver, ER camera. And by looking at how the form is the pattern that is emitted by the projector, they can figure out basically the layout or the depth of individual pixels. This is one principle, so which is basically an active stereo camera, and the other principle is time of flight, so where you have one single sensor that does some black magic and is able to imagine a flash LiDAR, right? Emits and then it senses the best at all the time. The return let's say, it emits, it makes a flash and then it listens for the return for an interval, and the later the return comes, the faster the point is, rudely speaking, or in principle. In the end, I use also phase mesh. And then these are sensors that we will use to sense the world, or classes of sensors in general. And okay. Right. So I was talking about RGB cameras, but that's going back to mobile bases. Well, a mobile base is an ensemble of sensor in general. We will treat it as a compound between an actuator and a sensor because it's a set of devices and appliances mounted together in a way that they provide an interface suitable for navigation. So mobile base is a trailer, can be a car, an autonomous car, can be a differential drive platform that mixes several subsystems and can go or has the capability to go from A to B in an environment. Okay? Normally, it's consisting of a set of wheels, like the, or also a quadrotor can be a mobile base. Classical, the ones that I like, are differential drive robots because they are cheap. They are consisting of two motors with associated wheels and a bunch of electronics and controllers to power these motors. And they take as an interface, they take as input a desired velocity of the platform, or a desired local position of the platform in a reference frame, and as output, they typically provide either the encoder readings integrated over time or some measure of what we call the odometry. The odometry, which is the process of integrating the encoder, the motion of the encoders, in order and knowing the kinematic parameters of the robot, in order to get the position of the robot on the plane. Okay? This is the process called odometry. Actually, like odometer comes from a special pen that was used to calculate the distances on the map. I think my grandfather had one. It was like kind of a pen which has a wheel at the end, and then you could adjust the scale with it to the scale with the map, and then in order to figure out how far was a street, you were rolling this pen on the map, on the trajectory, on the map, on the physical map, right? And then it was counting the distance you would have to travel. That was the concept of odometer. You have an odometer with two wheels, and then you have a differential drive robot with three wheels or four, and then you have an omnidirectional camera like the one that you see here on the bottom left. Or also you can have these humanoid robots that are also mobile platforms that carry a lot of sensors. Okay, now what happens if we want to do the cost is much less than 300 euro. Given that we wanted our own robot, wanted to have a robot that the students could build. Actually, like the cost of 300 euro is definitely inflated now. I think it's below 100 if you really go cheap. But if someone wants to have a mobile robot, you could simply follow the guide at this web page, and then you can construct a standard robot mobile platform at least. Then you can sensorize and you can play with. It's all open hardware, open firmware, open everything. In particular, I'm particularly proud of the firmware that actually now has been also used and extended by a brilliant student of mine to build an inverted pendulum, a Segway-like robot. And you could use the firmware of this on an Arduino to build your own platform or to also assemble your own sensor. Because imagine, it's not in the topic of this course, but being able to put together multiple devices and maybe timestamping them correctly might be interesting. It might be something if you ask by a company to do, well, you can get some money for it, right? And this concludes this part of the presentation. Then 3 minutes. This time I will not move from the lecture hall, and then I will start with the probability. In 45 minutes, I will try to do the basics of probability. Okay? So an overview of something you should know already, but let us give it a refreshment. So 5 minutes, and I'm back. E non uscirò da quest'aula.